Hey everyone, if you're watching this episode of the podcast on YouTube, just want to remind you, we stream the podcast live on Monday evenings exclusively for first members on our website. You can check out the link below for a 30-day free trial, and you can watch us Monday evenings and find out what's going on. Hello everyone, welcome to this week's episode of the podcast, brought to you by Betterment, MeUndies, and NatureBox.
Yes.
Thank you to our sponsors for sponsoring this episode of the podcast. I'm Gus.
I'm Gavin.
I'm Barbara.
I'm Bernie.
And I'm Gus. What's up with the shades?
I don't know. I had them here, so I put them on.
It makes you look angrier.
It does, right? I was just thinking the same thing. I feel like, here we go. I'll do this.
I think it's because we can't see your eyebrows.
They look like the Unabomber.
You're scaring me.
All right. I'll get rid of them.
Thank you.
Right. I forget why.
Put them back on.
Oh, fuck off.
How's everybody doing?
Well, you called me the F word 3 times today already. What's up? You got any sort of, what's up?
No, I was just greeting you. I was in a foul mood most of the day.
You called me an FO and an F stick.
You don't say, why are you saying F instead of what I call
you? You called me dickhead, cunt.
Slut. Slut. I didn't call you cunt. I didn't say cunt.
You didn't say cunt. You said slut. Other thing.
Well,
it's a term of endearment.
There's a motivation for that though, Barbara.
Why?
Because we have actually, do you want to do this right now? I'm super excited about it.
Oh yeah.
So
wait,
Barbara actually has a really big announcement. She had something really cool that happened to her this weekend. Can you guess what it is, either of you?
You're up the duff.
What does that mean?
I can't even guess what that
would
mean.
You say up the duff?
Yeah, knocked up.
Oh, what? I thought she was climbing up somebody's butt.
Spit take.
That's totally the way I heard that, Gavin.
Don't drink that water. Who's ever water that is?
All right, that's
if you want to play along with us, just tweet us at hashtag RTU podcast.
Hashtag.
And I will... You can guess what Barbara had this weekend.
She's climbing
that she
up
did,
someone's
so.
Butt.
Up the duff. Okay, then that's a new one.
Up the duff down the stream.
I don't know. What's your announcement? Is it about the new show?
Oh, that's a good one. That would be a good guess.
We could talk about that now or
so
later.
Is that a no? That's a no.
That's not, that's awesome, but that's not the thing.
I announced that last week.
You and Aaron broke up.
Close.
I'm so excited to tell everybody.
Very close. Very close. All right, Barbara, do you want to tell us what was the cool milestone that you hit this weekend?
So Gavin and I both moved here to the United States of America 5 years ago and have both been working really hard on trying to make our time here permanent.
Did you do it?
And this morning I received a message saying, congratulations, your green card was approved.
You're a resident now?
Barbara is now a resident alien. Is that what green card means?
Permanent resident.
Permanent resident.
Congratulations.
Barbara can stay in America.
It lines up. You hit me in the eye almost. There's no need to rub it in. I don't have one.
You want to join me up here?
Well, I don't have one yet.
So
I'll join you up there one day.
I was abusing Barbara all day today because now she's an American. And there's nothing Americans hate more than other Americans.
So now Barbara's
a resident.
No, she's
not American. Technically, she's not an American.
Nah,
she's a pretend American.
I can stay in America.
Not a citizen, but
a
permanent
American.
I'm a permanent resident.
So now Barbara's your citizens. Barbara is a permanent resident. And I'm some dude who has a long commute.
Yeah.
You got a really long commute.
You're living on your visa, dude.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what to tell you.
I was most excited to tell you out of all people.
I bet.
Very happy for you and proud of you.
This is not the reaction I was hoping for.
Your day
for.
Will come soon,
What
Gavin?
Do you want from me?
We wanted you to be miserable. We were hoping that you were going to be so sad.
Do you remember when you got your visa before you got mine? And I was like, hey, congratulations.
How do you feel, though? What's working underneath the surface there? What do you got?
Well, that's cool, and I want one, too.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough.
So, on a somewhat related note, not quite the same, I recently applied for and got my global entry, which is...
applied for it, didn't know this. They said, you're pre-approved. Now you have to schedule your interview in 30 days. Otherwise, you lose your $100.
Yes. You just have to schedule it. That doesn't mean the interview has to happen within 30 days. You
I think I have 4 days left that I have to do that.
Just schedule it. So the problem
you
is...
schedule it. Go ahead.
If you want to book it in Austin, like there's no slots left this year. You'd have to book for like early next year.
What?
So what I did was to get around it, I flew to Houston And I did my interview in Houston.
Is that the place you couldn't have your cell phone by any chance?
No, but okay. We were probably in the same office. I'll talk to you about that off camera.
Okay.
Wait, what? You couldn't have your cell phone?
When I went to go do my green card stuff, I wasn't allowed to have my cell phone in there.
I was the same at the embassy.
Because it's like a government.
It's like, yeah, government buildings. So
were you in a place, Gus, though, where you couldn't have your cell phone?
Yes.
You were?
Yeah.
What were you doing?
I can't. It's something
like related to family, so I don't really want to get into it. Okay. I can tell you later.
Okay, that's fair.
It's not like a Gus story.
Is it the most bored you've ever been?
It was terrible. I told a longer version of the story on a previous podcast. I think you guys weren't on it. The short version is, since you can't use your cell phone, there's nothing to do in that office. They have a TV on the wall, and they were playing Man of Steel.
Oh, that's not bad.
Then when it ended, they put Batman versus Superman on. I was like, oh my God. Anyway, okay, so all that aside. So I had to go to Houston to do my global entry, right?
You're going to be able to figure out where you were based on those 2 minutes.
So I booked my flight well in advance because I knew I was going. I had this date picked out. The date was months in advance. Then like the night before the flight, I got an email from the airline saying, hey, you've been complimentary upgrade to first class. I'm like, sweet. But when I look at my boarding pass on my phone, it doesn't have a seat. It says sea agent. I was like, oh, that's
what airline?
That was United.
But you said you got an email?
I hate that shit. Delta does that all the time.
And I was like, that's a little weird, but whatever. You know, I've seen it every now and then. It's a little unusual, but I've seen it before. So I get to the airport, and like before I go through security, I check where you first check in for the flight. And I'm like, hey, my boarding pass says sea agent. Is that something y'all can help me with? They're like, oh, no, just go to the gate. They'll take care of it there. I was like, okay. So I go through security. I go to the gate, and I'm like, hey, my boarding pass says sea agent. They're like, oh, okay, yeah, we'll take care of it. Just go sit down. We'll find you.
Uh-oh.
So like I sit down. And
seat 40D.
The plane starts boarding, and I'm like, something's happening. So I go up to the gate, and I'm like, hey, y'all still working on that? They're like, yeah. It turns out that the plane we got was smaller than the plane we thought we were going to get. So
what?
They said, you got upgraded from economy to first class, but the seat you're supposed to sit in first class doesn't exist.
So downgrade me back I'm like, to okay, the so, fucking seat that
I
exists. Like,
so I had a seat before.
So you went from in economy. A normal seat so you upgraded to outside to no of
the
plane. Seat.
But then they were like, well, we're trying to move you back to your seat in economy, but we can't get it to work. I was like, what do you mean you can't get it to work? She's like, it's just not working. Every time I do it, it says like, you know, some whatever database connection error. I was like,
someone took your seat.
And I was like, well, what are you going to do? Like, she was like, don't worry. You're going to get on the plane. You know, we'll get this straightened out. I was like, okay. So then like I sit down again. Everyone's bored at the plane. It's just me like left in the gate. And I'm like, I go to the desk. Like, she's not going to close the door, right? Like, I need to get on that plane. I've got
this
meeting.
Fucking with you at this point.
She's like, yeah,
they're
I don't know.
They're kicking that can down the road.
I like you being stuck outside and there being one empty seat on the plane and they just can't put you in it.
And then eventually she was like, it's like 5 minutes till we're supposed to take off. And the lady at the desk is like, you know what? Just go get on the plane.
What?
I was like, what? She goes, yeah, just.
I've never heard of that in my life.
Like, just get on
just
and.
Go
get
on the plane.
Yeah, and she's like, I'll fix it when you're in the air.
That's awesome.
I was like,
that's
okay.
Great.
So then
so the seat's empty, right? So you're not just like standing in a full plane.
Right.
Like you're the last one on the subway.
And it's not like he's some stranger who just strolled up and got on a plane.
Right.
He was
right,
like, on the original.
I was on
list.
There. They've checked. Right. I've already done all of that. So then I walk up to the gate and the lady's like, can I have your boarding pass? And I was like, she just told me to walk over here and get on the plane. She's like, oh, okay, yeah, go ahead.
So that would work? Just like, hey, let me on the plane. She said it's cool.
So where did you end up sitting?
In the bulkhead, like the first row of econ, which is where I booked myself.
He was
in
co-pilot that day.
Yeah, so
it's probably the equivalent of where your first class seat was, but it was.
Yeah, it's probably exactly the same spot. So I got on the plane and flew down to Houston. But then I was worried the whole time I was in Houston. I was like, if she didn't fix it and they think I didn't get on the first leg, they're going to cancel my return leg. So like the whole time I was stressed out. I was freaking out about that.
You should have just driven there.
Well, I thought it would be way easier just to fly.
Yeah.
The place also, I booked myself the interview. There's two interview locations in the Houston airport. One inside of security and one outside of security. I thought I'll book myself on the inside security one because there's less people going to go there. It's easier to get in and out. So yeah. I couldn't
have driven
there.
You also don't have to go back through security to go back on your flight.
Yeah. So that's why I didn't drive there.
Good answer.
So then I get there and it was an interesting experience. So again, since this is a government office, there's signs everywhere like no cell phones, and all of them are upside down for some reason, which was really weird to me.
Because you'll pay attention to them.
And
it's like that laundry when they.
What is it with that laundry?
What is it with that laundry? Is that in other parts of the world?
No, just here.
It's just in Austin.
I've only seen
there's
that.
There's a laundry.
Oh yeah, the quick laundry.
Yeah, there's a laundromat where you know.
It
when
says
you,
laundry. Laundry
and it's upside down. It just has an upside down.
It's
wave.
Like Canada's pizza. Laundry.
I don't know what that
Classic.
Means. So I walk into this office in Houston, right? And the office is about the size of this podcast set.
Oh, really?
It's tiny. And it's like one dude, like one customs officer at a desk.
Were they able
and
to order a smaller couch?
He's interviewing someone. I guess like doing their global entry interview. And he's like, I'll be with you in a minute. I'm like, okay. So I sit down, whatever. They finish up. And I go up to do my thing. And I'm talking with him. And I guess he can see all of my information because they do like a background check on you. And they have all, they have, you know, your whole life on the screen in front of them. He's like, filmmaker, huh? I was like, yeah. He goes, what kind of films do you make? Well, I was like, it's complicated. You know, we do stuff on the internet.
You make it sound like porn.
Yeah.
Immediately.
It's comedy. And he goes, oh, okay. He's like, I love movies. Like, I love watching movies. I was like, oh, really? He goes, yeah. He's like, I'm a huge fan of Wes Anderson movies. He's like, oh, what's that Wes Anderson movie that was filmed in Houston? I was like, oh, Rushmore. I said, I love Rushmore. It's one of my favorite movies. He goes, yeah, I love that.
Is he quizzing you?
I don't know. And this is going to make you question that even more.
Were you then like, shut the fuck up, I don't care about your life?
So then, true American fashion. So then he's like, yeah, he's like, I really like good films. You know, I hate that those trashy films. Like a friend of mine invited me over to his place. He's got a pool and he had a screening for that movie, Sharkdanko. I was like.
Sharkdanko?
Yeah, I was like, what? He's like, yeah, you know, Sharkdanko, the sharks, and they're like flying in the air. I was
flying
like,
the Dankos? Yeah,
I was like, okay. He goes, yeah. He's like, and then he's like, what's your favorite film? It's like, I don't know. I was like, I like Ghost World a lot. I think Ghost World's a really good movie. He goes, oh, yeah. He was like, I don't think I've seen that one. I was like, it's got Thor Birch and Scarlett Johansson. He goes, oh, yeah. It's also got Steve Buscemi in it, right?
Wow, this
like,
guy's, he's fucking with you at this point.
I was like, okay, like, is this a test? Like what you said.
He's fucking with you, it feels like. Because he heard you were a filmmaker, so he's testing you by throwing out stuff
that
he knows.
That can't be a real
wrong.
Thing they do.
Maybe, you don't know, Barbara.
I don't know, but
Americans are shifty, you'll find out.
I never said anything, I didn't question it. Got through the interview real fast and everything was fine. But it, like in my head, I'm like, was I being tested and did I fail some kind of test?
You should have been like, hey, what's that like natural disaster called where the wind's going in a circle?
A Tordanko.
Steve Buscemi dies in a Tordanko.
There was one other thing that he said. I can't remember what it was at the time. But
she starts messing up like government agencies. Like, yeah, I didn't pay taxes to the IRS. See if he calls you on it. See if he's really a government agent.
I didn't pay taxes to ISIS.
I love that on Barbara's first day with a green card, she wore the most fucking Canadian shirt that you could possibly imagine. She looks like a lumberjack Mountie.
I also have camo pants
on. Is that a Canadian thing?
Yeah, I think so. Camouflage?
So, since you've taken one more step down the road to becoming an American citizen, is that the goal? Are you going to become an American citizen?
No.
No?
You have to be
like
a resident
and, like,
for 5 years.
12 hours out of your day so you could save like 5 minutes at a time over the next 10 years?
I would like an out if Trump becomes president.
You just come back to Canada.
Exactly.
Yeah, but are you taking one more step down the road towards American citizenship, at least?
All I want to do is be able to live here and not have to worry about it.
I bet Gavin would like that, too.
If they said
you got to give up your British citizenship and we'll give you residency today, you just got to give it up.
No.
No?
Yeah. I'm going
to
do that.
See, Gavin and I would have to give up our citizenship to get American citizenship.
Right.
Really?
Yeah.
Today.
You can
make a decision. You can be a U.S. citizen.
You just have to renounce.
Yeah. Is that a thing? Do you have to go, like, hold your hand up and say some special words?
Bye.
Orange monkey eagle.
Sorry.
No, so, I mean, like, if you're stuck as an American citizen, you have to pay American taxes no matter where you are or where you earn
it's
money.
The same with Canada. If you're a Canadian resident or citizen, you have to pay taxes on all your income,
yeah, but
even
just,
outside Canada. But I became a non-resident. So
right, but Americans can't do that. No. You can't just be a non-resident.
Really?
It's like you're in or you're out, you're paying taxes if you're a citizen.
Yeah, I just had to file this paperwork that's like, most
places are like that.
The only way to get out of it is to renounce your U.S. citizenship. And even then, when you renounce it, it's not necessarily that easy. I've heard before that when some people try to renounce their citizenship for this reason, the government will force them to pay projected lost tax revenue over the rest of their life.
I wonder if there's like a swap you could do with someone trying to get citizenship.
Yeah, I love the idea of like going to apply to not be a citizen and the U.S. is just like, no, denied. You're one of us still.
You'll pay us the next 30 years of your life taxes right now.
We
and then we'll
sign a contract. How can they do that? It's like, I'm not a citizen anymore. Go fuck yourself.
What if you fake your own death?
Prepay
taxes? I've heard that. Let me verify it just to be safe.
What if you fake your own death? Does that count?
It's fraud.
Well, if you fake it, then they don't know. If you're bad at faking it, then yeah, you probably get in trouble for that. You can just ask them that in the interview. They go, oh, you owe us $80,000 in taxes. Go, but I'm dead.
I'm a ghost.
I'm fake dead. You can't get me to pay taxes. So somebody on Twitter whose name is Boston Tom, who says he's a British citizen with a name like Boston Tom. I can't think of a least
maybe his
a
name's
less
Tom Boston.
A British name to call yourself than Boston anything. But I don't have to give up. I didn't, excuse me, have to give up my British citizenship when I became a U.S. citizenship. That's, that was exactly how I wrote that. So apparently, when Boston Tom got his U.S. citizenship, he did not have to give up.
Boston Tom, what year did that happen?
Boston Tom. Does anybody believe that a guy named Boston Tom is really?
Might be well, a place maybe in... now he lives in Boston.
Well, yeah, he does, but it's like, I don't know. If I'm British, I'm not moving to Boston. That's such an important city for the American Revolution.
I'm changing
the
my
fuck out of Boston.
Twitter handle to Austin Gav.
Austin Gav.
Gav ATX.
I find like everything on me pops a lot more. Like lately.
As you get old?
Maybe it's because we've had so much goddamn rain in Austin.
It makes you pop?
That have to do with your bones popping?
There's barometry gets off. The barometer gets all wonky and then your pressure. You get pressures. And
oh, the pressure?
Up. There you go. I got a lot of pressure power.
You think that affects more than just flying a lot?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've been flying a bunch too.
I get headaches now. I get a day-long headache after I fly.
I flew recently and was next to a guy who just wanted to talk the entire time.
You see, you got a friendly face.
No, but it wasn't just to me. He was in the middle seat. I was on the aisle seat, and there was a guy on the window seat. And he was talking to the guy on the window seat when I sat down, thinking like, oh, maybe these guys knew each other, or like
you
they
just got
to
give
off.
Answers that are too short. Not rude, but just like...
No, that doesn't always, that doesn't always work.
I had my headphones in. He was like... looking at something I was doing, I was playing Candy Crush on my phone because like my laptop was dead.
He probably just thought you were hot and wanted to flirt.
He was like an older guy. And like he kept asking me what level I was on. And then he ordered, you know those bottles of wine you could get on the flights?
Like, hey, baby, you want citizenship?
They're about this big.
I got the fast track.
Yeah.
These are the bottles of wine you could get on flights. He ordered 4 of these.
Let me show you my global entry. I had a friend who was recently on a plane. And he sat next to you, and I'm going to be very vague about this. It was some months ago, and this person was on a plane, and I was on the same plane, and I saw this person get on the plane and talk to every other person, like, in the aisle's seat as she came down the aisle. And I was like, wow, that person is chatty. And I was sitting far in front of my friend, and she also had a dog, a full-size dog, with her. Like a decent sized dog.
Was it one of those service dogs?
It was a service dog. She ended up sitting right next to my friend on the plane. And the service dog had to like go underneath the seat in front of her, like barely fit. But luckily it was a well trained dog.
Been there. He
was
like, I actually had the dog and a baby on either side of me.
Were you really?
Yeah.
How big was the dog?
It's a service dog. Sort of wedged under the.
So what was
there was a comic about it.
What was your service dog? What kind of service was the dog providing?
Like a lab?
It was like a military dog.
It was a FEMA dog. What's I was on that flight with you, right? From Baltimore?
Oh, it was a FEMA dog?
Oh. What's FEMA?
FEMA is, I don't know what it stands for, but it's like the...
Federal Emergency Management?
Yeah, it's emergency something. Response. Like, it's FEMA's the team that went into New Orleans after Katrina.
Yeah. Were you on that flight?
When you said what type of dog, I thought you meant what, like...
That's a rescue
what
dog.
What actual type of dog?
Like a...
And I was like a lab?
That's either a rescue dog or an even sadder kind of dog, which is a dog that's there to find dead bodies. Probably.
Yeah, but if just give it a treat afterwards, it'll be fine.
No, I'm just saying it's just a sad purpose to train a dog to find dead bodies. That's rough. What do you think that dog was for? Anything else that FEMA would have a dog for, Gus?
Probably to find bodies. I would
yeah,
imagine.
Right?
Yeah.
Does it look for the bones? Does it look for the FEMA?
Well, they're not.
Very good. That's a good one.
It's a well-trained FEMA dog.
So it used to be if you renounce your citizenship, you had to file taxes for the next 10 years anyway. That is no longer the case. But if your net worth is over $2 million, you have to pay exit tax.
Whoa, how much is exit tax?
It does not say.
Oh,
$1 million.
So my friend was in no mood to like deal with all this because she was chat. And
Which friend was this?
I can't tell you.
Why?
So it was months ago.
What did he do? He poisoned the dog?
No, he said, but he's sitting there. And so he made one mistake and he asked the lady a question. He said, it's a service dog. What kind of service dog is it? And it was an emotional support dog.
Mm-hmm.
What is that?
It's like there to keep you calm.
Maybe it's people who've experienced like traumatic personal.
Like with plane or something
yeah,
like that?
It just gives you nice affection if you're nervous.
Yeah, but it's like.
Distraction.
Like, what's the training
like
that you give the dog to do that? Just like.
Just a real friendly dog.
Just a friendly dog? It like watches out? Does it
yeah,
like,
I think the dog picks up on cues, like when you're upset.
Oh, you know,
or when
I saw a commercial
wrong.
With a veteran who had PTSD and the dog woke him up from a bad dream. Yeah. That's the kind of thing that it is?
Or even just like to like.
Never have heard of that.
Come
before.
Up to get pet when you see you're upset.
Never have heard of that.
So, I've seen that before.
It's pretty awesome, though.
Yeah.
That dogs can be used for that.
Dogs are so versatile.
Didn't they do something at an airport where there was, like, a huge delay or, like, some huge issue and, like, every flight was delayed for, like, days and they brought in dog, like, comfort dogs?
I think that was in Washington. I want to say it was in Washington, D.C. Like, they had dogs.
Or, like, people who
were,
like,
why were the flights delayed?
It was some, like, big disaster.
It was Dankos? Dankos everywhere. They couldn't fly the plane because all the fucking Dankos.
Sharp Dankos.
Real bad weather. They had F5 Dankos everywhere. here, I got something I want to read.
They named it James. James Danko.
Everyone, this episode of the podcast is brought to you by MeUndies. Whether you're wearing a suit or sweats, you spend almost 24 hours a day in your underwear. But instead of making a statement like Superman's tights under his everyday clothes, your underwear is probably boring. MeUndies is here to change that. Every pair of MeUndies is made from sustainably sourced modal, a fabric that's twice as soft as cotton. Nothing can describe the fit and feel of MeUndies, but once you try them on, you'll understand why they're called the world's most comfortable underwear. And if you don't love your first pair of MeUndies, they are free, no questions asked. MeUndies has dozens of styles and limited edition prints to help you make a statement with your underwear, whether anyone can see them or not. Remember, Superman. Shipping is free in the U.S. and Canada. You can save up to $8 a pair with the MeUndies subscription plan. Get a subscription or a single pair. Get 20% off your first order when you go to MeUndies.com/roosterteeth. That's MeUndies.com/roosterteeth for 20% off your first order. MeUndies.com/roosterteeth. Big thank you to MeUndies. I am wearing their underwear right now.
Show me.
That's a great mental.
Prove it.
Oh, they cut away from you.
I have that same pattern.
They're fucking running for the camera. No, you're not getting a close-up on that.
We are. Get in there, man. Mix it up.
I mean,
don't be shy.
So why have we got wheels now?
Yeah, we have a whole bunch of new studio equipment that the audience can't see.
So, people on Twitter are explaining to me what an emotional support dog does. Emotional support dogs react to cues. I think they mean a different kind of cue. And are taught to ground the person by laying down on them. That would freak me out if a dog fucking laid on me. Among other things.
I was thinking it was going to rain.
There's probably...
aren't there also, like, some dogs...
the barometry is off.
That they can help, like, people with really bad diabetes. Like, they can smell when people's blood sugar is off.
Really?
Oh, whoa.
Because you can't tell. Supposedly, you can't tell when you're having low or high blood sugar.
Right.
Even though people... Or maybe that's blood pressure. I'm thinking about blood pressure.
See, for pressure, you need a barometer.
For pressure, you do need a barometer.
No. You can tell when you have low blood sugar. You can tell really easily. So I think it's high blood
pressure. Maybe it's high
pressure.
Blood sugar.
People will say, I have high blood pressure. I feel like I have high blood pressure. But there's just literally no way to tell if you have it or not.
What is it called when you feel disconnected from the earth?
I probably have asked this. What where you don't feel connected?
Astronaut syndrome.
Whenever I would have, like, whenever I got, like, panic attacks, the feeling that I always got was that things would flatten out. Like, everything felt two-dimensional to me. I don't know how else to explain it.
And what would trigger those for you?
Well, it was right after college, and I finished my movie, graduated from college, and broke up with my girlfriend all within a one-month period.
Oh, Jesus.
And I guess I didn't realize the amount of stress or, like, the end of a lot of stress.
Big punch.
Yeah, and I just, like, what triggered it for me was I was doing something... It was like cleaning out a box of shit that I had. Like, it was just like random knickknacks and stuff. I felt that I'm going to go through that box. I'm going to throw it away. And there was a bunch of dust and everything got in my nose and everything. And I got like a really fast heart rate from that. Like, I don't know why. I got like 120, 130. And I thought...
How'd you measure it?
What does that mean? It's you just count.
You could count, yeah.
I don't know how to measure your heart rate.
No, I mean, like, you went out of your way to think, man, my heart's fast, I'm going to measure it.
I know how fast 120 is. I'm just saying it was beating very fast. What's your resting heart rate, Gavin? What would you say? What's a normal resting heart rate for a human being?
70?
There you go. Yeah, you're right. I think 72 is what it is.
My resting heart rate's actually really fast.
Is it fast?
Yeah.
Really?
Mine's usually about, like, 90.
You burn out?
90?
You're not 90, are you really?
Mine's normally around 92.
I just have a really fast 92? Heart rate.
90 as well, fucking dickhead.
Well, you know what Lance Armstrong's is?
It was like 45 or something.
12. Yeah, it was like 40.
Is it like if you're more athletic?
How much did the steroids take off of that?
What's that?
How much did the steroids take off of that?
I don't know.
It's fucking. Is you it think like he injected his steroids straight into his fucking slow ass heart?
If you're allegedly. In better allegedly. Shape.
He admitted
slower,
it, didn't he?
Right?
That he injected steroids into his heart. I missed that. Well,
that part was a joke, obviously.
Yeah, he did. He admitted it to Oprah.
To using the steroids.
You know what the weird thing about Lance Armstrong's, and let's go back to Barbara's, what do you want to know?
I just heard that if you're more, like, in shape, it's slower.
It is.
But I don't know if that's true.
Well, if it beats faster, you'll burn off a lot of more calories.
Well, people have different size hearts, too.
Yes, they do. They do, Gavin.
A big heart would be slow.
Yeah, like a 5-year-old kid has a different size heart than a 30-year-old man.
People like hearts.
Slightly different size.
People like
right.
hearts.
So it'd be faster.
Hmm? Yes. A baby's heart rate is faster.
Because their heart is smaller.
But their bodies are also smaller, right? So it's like less force needed to move the blood around?
Well, it's still got to get up to the brain pretty quick, isn't it?
It's newer
blood.
Yeah, but
it's not as much of a distance.
Yeah, but I mean, what's that to that on a baby like that?
Right.
Not that much.
Like, but babies are growing. So the heart has to be sure it can keep up if there's like a little bit
like
of stretch.
Like the head's getting further away. It has to like constantly be shooting for where the head's going to be.
So it's the same amount of beats. It's just spread over a larger body. That's the way it works.
Yeah, okay, right.
$1 million, but your heart is big enough that it only needs to beat once a minute.
No way.
But you can feel every beat because it'd be like, and you'd feel all your blood go like.
That would be terrible to live with.
Would you be able to sleep?
That's the worst thing ever. That's the worst thing ever described. No,
and then a minute later,
it'd
be like
$1 million for that. Every time I slide around in my seat, by the way, the camera guys are having to shift everything. So.
Well, they got wheels now, so it's fine.
It's easy.
Those podcast chairs are always so slippery.
I end up doing the Gus, like, slow and steady slide down.
So you had a high heart rate.
And I used to be a lot more of a hypochondriac. My mother raising me, I feel like she was a very nervous person. She was always worried we were going to get hurt, always worried we were going to get sick. And it's like, that's why with my kids, it's like, play in the dirt and have fun. And I did all that stuff. Like, I played in the dirt constantly, but she was mainly worried about us getting hurt. That was the main thing. Or we get, like, some kind of, like, serious sickness. And so, as a result of that, I was kind of like a hypochondriac. And when I had this, like...
Is there a T on the end of that word?
Hypochondriac?
No.
No, C I at think the it's end. Just a C.
Did I say T? Hypochondriac?
I think you said it right.
I think I might have said it with a T. I think he's right. Mm. Hypochondriac.
You think that's right?
Oh, you did say it with a T there.
No, I said it with a T that time on purpose. But
I think there's
to think
no T. Hypochondriac.
Yeah.
I think I said it with a T. I think I did. Anyway.
I think we should spend 3 more minutes talking about
shush.
This.
So I had this fast heart rate. I thought something was physically wrong with my heart. I thought I was having a heart attack. That made me way more nervous.
Oh,
and kind of like it was this like thing that fed on itself. And so then later, like the next day, when I had like a panicky moment, I thought I was having another one of these episodes. I thought it was a physical problem. So I did this whole thing where like I went to see a cardiologist. And they gave me a monitor. That
cardiologist?
Yeah. And they gave me only hypochondriacs can go to cardiologists. And they gave me a monitor that I wore for like 24 hours. And they go, you're fine. And like literally I probably went through like 2 or 3 weeks with different doctors, general practitioner, specialist and everything. And then just one guy goes, you probably just got a lot of anxiety. You're probably just stressed out. So, and it was something weird. Not going to happen for everybody. And I don't want to, imply that it's this easy for a lot of people. But when somebody told me it was like it was a mental thing, I was like, oh, because I was scared of like having something that was going to cause me to pass out and have a heart attack and die and go into cardiac arrest. Whereas now I knew I was stressed. I could de-escalate very quickly.
I think I remember when that happened to you. I knew you at that time, right?
You may have.
So
you may have.
I remember you like coming to work one day and you're saying like, yeah, they figured it out. They said it's anxiety attacks. And you're like, they gave me these pills to take, but I'm not going to take them.
Yeah, it was. they gave me Zoloft. And I was like, and that was a big thing for me too. I was like, I kind of got the feeling.
Is that for depression?
Yeah, if I started taking that. This was like late 90s. So they probably have way better stuff for anxiety now. But they gave me Zoloft at the time, and I was like, I felt like if I started taking that pill, I would never stop. So I thought, I'm going to try to tackle this on my own.
Yeah, you'd probably get some sort of addiction to it.
I had the opposite of that the other day.
Reliance.
Where I was alone at home, Meg's out of town. It was really quiet, and I felt like just numb, and I didn't really feel like I was fully awake. And
I feel like your heart was broken.
Oh, you know what that sounds like? That sounds like sleep paralysis. Were you in bed?
No, it was just the middle of the day. It was like 2 p.m.
Where were
you? I was awake. I was just at home in my living room. I was walking around. I was just like, I feel like detached from the world right now. I feel detached from reality.
Yeah. I know that feeling.
You're all
like,
alone in a big
I couldn't really feel my footsteps very well. I couldn't.
You're also probably over-focusing on it. Like, were you over-focused on, like, all your body and...
Yeah.
Yeah. I know that feeling very well. Yeah.
So I just had to, like, just quickly, like, turn on video games and stuff.
It's like when you start thinking about the size of your tongue in your mouth and you can't stop thinking about how big your tongue is.
Everyone listening to the podcast right now hates you.
I know.
I can't sit in my apartment without any sort of noise at all.
Yeah.
Like if I'm home, I live alone, so I'm always alone.
Do you ever get too quiet?
Yeah, I can't be in my apartment without something.
Do you have a white noise machine, or do you just like turn on a TV? Or
I either turn on a podcast, the TV, just to like anything, or just like I put Netflix on.
I think that's what triggered it because usually there's Meg is home and the dog is always running around like an arsehole. dog's gone, Meg's gone, the cat was asleep, and the air conditioning was off.
Oh,
and it was
God.
Just like complete silence.
And you weren't doing anything?
I just come from like one of the other rooms. I was just walking around. I was like, maybe this is all a dream and maybe I don't live here.
Like you just really lost it. Yeah, you've lost your connection to the earth.
Yeah. Someone's saying what Gavin is saying every time he talks about it, you're called what that is called is disassociation. So yes, that is disassociation.
Could you experience that with a human? Like, could I disassociate from Gavin?
You got a green card, so you can easily disassociate from Aaron now. Be like, I got a green card.
First thing you said to me, wasn't it?
I said it during a management meeting.
What was that?
Well, I announced this morning at the management meeting that I got the green card.
It's literally said from the other side of the room at a management meeting, good, now you can dump Aaron.
And then you followed up with, don't anybody say anything so we can tell Gavin on the podcast.
Yeah. That is true, I did.
I don't know why you thought I'd be mad.
I don't know.
Maybe not mad, just like jealous.
Have any reaction?
Aggravated?
Not be disassociated
from
it?
Soul,
I
mean,
don't really get jealous. I'm just happy for you. And I do want one.
Oh. You know, that is true. I should have. Should have realized that because Gavin does not get jealous. There's two things about Gavin that I think the average person who watches all of your videos, both across Achievement Hunter, Rooster Teeth, and the Slow-Mo Guys.
Oh, wow.
Two things I don't think they realize about you. One is that you don't get jealous at all, which I find to be a very interesting trait. But Barbara, as a woman,
it's been a problem
do you want your guy to get a little jealous or whatever? Tiny bit?
No. I mean, jealous in the way that like...
Well, jealous is a negative. So when you describe it as jealous, it's already gone too far.
I want someone to appreciate me.
Right. And value, like kind of... I'm not saying Gavin doesn't value
and like
stuff.
Feel lucky to have me.
Right.
So like if, you know, maybe they see you with like another guy or something, they'll like get that tinge of like, oh, no, that's mine.
Yeah.
Like maybe that in that sense.
Like maybe jealous is
not in the like, who are you talking to?
You want a touch of possessiveness, a touch.
Like
investment.
Like 0.0001%.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
See, jealous is a weird word because once you say jealous, they've already crossed that.
Possessiveness is also kind of a weird
word. It is a weird word. It's not a great way to say that.
I just want someone to feel fortunate.
What's the second thing about Gavin, in fact? The other thing about Gavin is probably the most trustworthy person, I think, for like when you talk to him. Gavin will never repeat anything anybody else says.
It's true.
It's no one's business.
No, I know. I've talked to Gavin about some stuff over the years. I know he'll never tell anybody else. And Gavin and I have been on like long trips together. We spent a lot of time together. He's never related to me anything else that anyone else has said. Am I saying that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's like Gavin does not reveal that. So I consider Gavin to be one of those people who's a vault. Probably more so than anyone else I've ever met in my
life.
Maybe
you aren't real.
So if you ever want to murder somebody, you let Gavin know.
Let Gavin know.
Tune into my new show next month called Other People's Problems.
we got a tweet from Andy using hashtag RT Podcast.
Who? Andy Cortez?
Yeah, who reminds us that for some people now you have to say, hey Cortana, turn off.
Oh, yes.
Don't get me started on that piece of shit addition to the Xbox.
Why did they change it?
I like your cable.
Here's the problem I have with it.
Piece of shit, Andy Cortez.
the problem I have with it is, my wife is not a video game player.
Yeah.
And she regularly talks to the Xbox. And now she says, like, Xbox, do whatever. And I'm like, no, you have to say, hey, Cortana. And I said, why?
Yeah.
Like, it worked.
And it works totally differently. So, for example, I it changed. So I'm getting used to it. I'm like, hey, Cortana, go to Netflix or open Netflix. This is one of that. It then opens up a Bing search with Netflix filled in. Do I want to Bing Netflix? Is that really what the stupid thing thought I wanted to do? How did no one testing it try and open an app with it?
You can't open apps. It's just like they changed the words, right?
They want to use
like,
Bing.
I don't want to Bing anything.
Yeah, what are you going to do?
And you're now, like, for example, if you want to, like, I used to say Xbox off all the time. It would say, are you sure? You say yes. It goes off immediately. Now it goes, hey, Cortana, turn off. And it's like listening. And then it goes, turn off. And then it does a thinking thing. It says yes or no, and you say yes.
It
takes like three or four times longer.
Yes,
why is it so much longer? Just because of the update?
Because it has to go through the internet now. It's like sending commands. It's like Siri.
You're right.
Fuck.
Before, it was just like a local thing between you and your Xbox. Xbox off, it goes off.
Now it's like, we think he wants to use Bing.
Do you
we really think.
Do you want to Bing how to turn off an Xbox? Yeah,
here we go.
I want to disable it. Apple TV by any chance?
I do.
Have you ever used the microphone?
I love that
it?
Thing.
Is that going to the internet or just within the Apple TV?
I assume it's going to the internet.
I think it's the same as Siri, so it goes
through the internet.
Yeah.
Interesting.
But anybody have an Alexa? I guess it's not called an Alexa. It's called an Echo.
Yeah, I do.
I love that.
I want one.
Do you know you can change how you talk to it? Like you say Alexa, to get it to respond to you. Mm-hmm. But you can also change that so you can say Echo or Amazon to
it. Can you change anything? Like, what if I wanted to talk to it and go, oh,
it's a drop down.
No, it's one of the three. Yeah.
Change to something like,
I think the thing they said, it was like, we only suggest you change it from something other than Alexa if there's someone in your household named Alexa.
Right. It's like, weird, though, to have a product.
Always listening?
No, that has a name, but that the name you call it isn't the name of it.
Yeah, that like seems weird Echo to me. Instead of-
I bought an Echo and I immediately call it
Alexa.
I feel
like even they can't figure it out. Like, the app used to be called Echo. And now it's Alexa, or the other way around. They changed
it. Yeah, they're moving it. I wouldn't be surprised if it's called the Amazon Alexa.
Just call it Amazon thing.
The Amazon Pylon, or whatever it is.
It can now control your thermostat, which is nice.
I went on a home automation tear.
I love it.
Do you just have like all those like Wi-Fi enabled lights?
I got a lot of stuff. I'm not going to go into detail as to what I have, because I don't want Gus getting in there and messing with my stuff.
I'll mess with your stuff.
But I walk around my house like just shouting shit all the time. Like, do this, do that, do this. Tell me what this is.
Well,
you know?
You use dictation more than anyone I know.
I use dictation constantly because I can't type for shit.
Which is why whenever you talk about Jeff in a text, it's spelled J E F F, and I'm like, do you not know how to spell his name? And
I realize, yeah. I just see it and I'm like, I don't give a fuck. So, when have I ever just said that to you? With Jeff with a J E F F.
It happened once.
You're still talking about it.
Have you ever dictated an email before, like a really long email?
I dictate scripts.
Really?
Yeah, I used Dragon Dictate in a boy, that was awesome, Gavin. I saw it. I used it in a headset. Actually, if you look on my desk right now, I've got one of those.
I've seen it.
Blue microphones. It looks like a big radio mic. Uh-huh. And I put that right in the middle of my keyboard, and I just talk when I want to write stuff.
That's great. That's
cool.
It was maddening so watching you type.
I'm terrible. I've typed like probably 15 or 16 feature length scripts.
Why did you do it?
More than that, probably in the high 20s. And I can't type.
Yeah.
It always all my friends laugh at me because I can't type.
You look younger today.
It was.
She does, doesn't she?
I look younger?
You look like 20 today.
I have to play an older part, so I've been like aging myself out. And like one of the things is growing like a big scraggly beard and everything. So it's like this week I have to go do a thing. It's not a Rooster Teeth thing, but I got to go play a person.
Is that why you're so grumpy?
Older than myself. So.
Is that why you're so grumpy?
No, you know what? I'm grumpy because, should we talk about this? I'm grumpy, honestly, because I saw the fucking set for your new show, and it's way fucking better. Also, it's done, completely done, and it's
what
a badass.
What are you looking at me? It's not my fault.
It's a badass set.
Not building our fucking set.
And
I'm waiting too.
I was like, what the fuck?
Well, I mean, we premiered really
about
soon.
It. I can fucking wait like an adult.
This is like the green card. Very happy for you.
Thank
Very
you.
Happy. But as an American, what? Gus, come on.
Yeah, the set's fine.
What
this one?
The fuck?
No, my set.
Oh,
you didn't see it. You weren't here this morning, I don't think.
It's
I've
dope.
Seen like there's pieces of it over there.
Every time they make a new set, it's better than the last one. And I would like to point out, this was the first one. So it follows that trend perfectly. God damn it.
It was better than every other set we had before it.
What was that?
This was better than every other set we had before it.
But think about
well,
it.
Well, back when the set was a poster hanging on the wall of the conference room?
Exactly, this is better.
Dickhead.
Metal table.
Think of it like this, though. The longer we wait for this, and the more sets that get made in between now and then, the better our set will be.
I would believe that if I couldn't see our set, like, right behind me in shambles, the new podcast set, which is just look like, it's like an abandoned project. It's like one of those places in the desert where fucking airplanes are buried in the sand. That's what our set looks like.
It's also
like
someone's
there.
Office.
Yeah, like, there's shit
Someone
stored on it and everything.
Someone using it as their office right
I
now.
I asked Patrick right before this.
Well,
that has
a chair on it.
I said,
couple chairs.
I go, when did you... It's hard to explain, but we made a change to the set where they're usually on rolling platforms. This set is not. So it takes the crew like, how much longer does it take to set this setup every week? How much longer?
30 minutes.
A lot longer.
30 minutes longer?
Like twice as long.
Like, a lot longer.
A lot longer. He won't even commit to how long it is.
Why did it change?
What?
Why did it change?
Because they needed our platform on which to build our new set. And I said to Patrick, when did we move the set off the platform so we could start building the new set
was
on the
April?
Platform.
Probably a year ago.
And I was like, he was like, July. I go, I think it was May. And somebody else goes, it was March. And Patrick was like, all right, March. Yeah. Because I forget what you said, Patrick, but they hadn't done something by that point. And that was way back in March. That's when our set moved off the
so
platform.
So this is why you're grumpy?
And now we're all sitting on the floor. Hey, Barbara, it's too long. It's
patience,
too long.
Have patience.
It's too long. That, yeah. I mean...
Well, could I segue into saying that the show that I announced last week, Always Open,
Yes.
It's actually premiering September 1st.
Now, is it premiering September 1st, or is that that you're shooting it?
Premiering.
So you're going to... What's the release schedule for Always Open?
It's going to be four pilot episodes for first members only.
Can it replace on the spot?
It's going to be Thursday nights at 10:30 p.m. Central. It's not live streamed, so you can watch it at any point in time. And then we're going to do those four episodes, and then if it gets greenlit and good to go, we're going to start doing Wednesday nights at 10:30 p.m. Central for first members, and Thursday night 10:30 p.m. Central for everyone else.
A little bit of late night action.
Late night action, yeah.
Bit saucy.
So September 1st, be looking out for that. We're actually filming our first episode this week.
Nice. Congrats.
Thank you.
Congrats on everything today.
It's been a good day.
It's a big day.
Had a Red versus Blue episode come out this weekend. It was just a...
And you did it.
A very, very Barbara-filled weekend. What?
No, I'm very happy for you with your green jealous. Card and your fucking awesome set and everything else. I'm just
sitting
happy.
On the ground, smoldering.
It was like every time I looked at, I can't even explain it all because I don't want to ruin it for people when I go see it. But they're like, oh, look what this does. This does this. I'm like, mother. Like, and this thing, we got this thing and it'll do this. And it's like, I'm like,
did you do your face of like, that's cool, I'm mad.
No, I was very happy.
You
I
sent
was
me
very
some,
happy.
Some nice messages.
I was like, here's exactly how it went down. I was like, show me this. Oh, that's cool. That's really cool. What's that? That's really cool. Guys, this set is really fucking awesome. Matt, come here, I need to talk to you. That's basically so the way that
opposite
went down.
We have ends of the jealousy spectrum here between Gavin and Bernie.
It's a great set. It's a great set. It's a great set.
Well, I think you're just learning about something. Gus runs the Rooster Teeth podcast. I run this podcast. And which one?
There we go.
Oh,
truth be told.
Whatever. It doesn't matter.
Gus is fine.
It's fine.
Hey, Gus, let's buy a smaller couch.
Yeah, let's do that.
How long did I bug you to buy a smaller couch for the Rooster Teeth podcast set? Was it a year and a half?
Who cares? I don't know.
2 years? By the way, I see this. Do you see this couch everywhere?
No.
I see it in like so many movie productions. It's usually white though,
yes.
Instead of this black.
In my nightmares, does that count?
You don't like this couch? I actually kind of like this couch.
I love this couch.
Yeah.
You don't have to sit on it.
The only thing I don't like about this couch is
I'm taking this for my office.
It's bigger than the old couch, but you can't lay down on it.
I don't like that it collects little crumbs in the holes.
Just don't drop shit on it.
Well, I mean, if it was my couch, I wouldn't have anything in it.
Problem solved.
I'm a tidy bastard.
Do you have crumbs in your holes?
Not ever. I pay special attention to the
bum crumbs.
The ribs.
Crumb holes.
Ashley found something in my belly button.
Everyone gets bum
crumbs.
What
does that mean?
She picked a bit of like
tadpole
dark lint out of my belly button
from a t-shirt or something.
Yeah. From like a black t-shirt.
Yeah.
I'm like horrified now. I'm just like,
well, because that was like a new step in the relationship.
Well, I didn't know that my belly button had ever collected lint before. I
mean, you never checked it.
I've cleaned my belly button many times, but I never to the point where I thought I never pulled out like nugget of whatever. It was a bit of fluff. It wasn't like
how big was this nug?
It was just a little fluff. It was fluff. It wasn't nugget. It wasn't crusty or anything. It was just fluff. But it was still enough to make me go.
Well, I have a question for you. Are you the kind of person who likes picking things like pimples or like if there's like an ingrown hair like pulling
a
that
groomer.
Out? Yeah.
Ashley's very much. She's always like picking at me.
Like you get pleasure out of it.
She's like the eyebrow thing that Gavin has, I have that too, where I have a couple super long hairs in my eyebrow. Those don't last. Those are gone.
Oh, see, they're like the base of your eyebrow.
No, when Ashley sees them,
they're
gone.
It's like an eyebrow trellis.
Did I ever tell you about my neck hair?
No.
Sounds like the beginning to the best story ever.
I can hit like 1900
okay.
Die.
Gus, I would like for you to tell me the story of Barbara's neck hair.
The story of Barbara's neck hair is that she's got one hair on the side of her neck, this side over here, and it grows out really long and thin. And then every now and then she has to pluck it, but she plucks it, it's like she doesn't feel it at all.
It's like an invisible hair.
Right.
Okay.
That's wrong.
No, that's it.
Barbara's neck hair, it's in the front where her Adam's apple used to be, and it's like a one long hair that grows out that, and if she gets embarrassed, because every now and then it's like a long hair in the front, so it's kind of like in the beard, male facial hair region that women don't ever want to have hair in. Go.
It's a hair on your neck that
you
is connected
this.
At both ends, oh. And you don't know which way it's growing, but it's growing in a loop.
It's like a rainbow.
So I, at all times, have one neck hair, and I'll always pluck it when I see it.
Let me tell you something. You have thousands of neck hairs.
But
I know, right?
Whenever I pluck it, the next day it'll be in a different area. It's like a fucking whack-a-mole.
So it's only one at a time.
One
like
at a time,
but in different locations.
Yeah,
that's bizarre.
Like right now,
it is in the front.
Yeah, it's right here right now. You see it?
So it's trying to get away. Like every time you pluck it, it's trying to find a new hiding spot. It's like she's not going to find
it. See, there's loads of hairs and one of them is just stuck out. That's all that's happened there.
But then I'll pluck it and then the next day another one will be like long in a different place.
Long.
Long.
I'm sorry I pronounced the G in long.
Do you do that all the time?
What do you say?
Like, what have I just done to you there?
I don't know. What have you done? I don't even know what that is.
I was giving her something.
Give?
No.
Hand me something?
No.
I don't, well,
oh
dude,
my god. So they Miles did a shot out of your belly button and they found lint in your belly button?
Oh, yeah.
What are you gross. Trying to say?
I've got lint just about every day. That's not a gross thing to me.
I was trying to get you to say giving.
Giving.
Ass lint?
Giving.
What? Somebody asked me on Twitter. I guess Bernie doesn't ever get ass lint either.
I have no idea what that means.
No idea.
What is ass lint?
What is it like? Explain that.
Anal collection?
All purpose nerd.
You wouldn't get any ass lint from Modal. Just letting you know.
There you go.
You already read the sponsor read.
Just reminding you.
Let him talk
about
it.
What you did
this.
Was drag a MeUndies read into ass lint.
That's like, ironically, that was your best segue to an ad read ever in the history.
The ad's already gone.
In the history of the show. Done.
Hey, you know what? I want to remind you, this episode of the podcast is also brought to you by Nature Box. I've got some Nature Box back here. You guys want to snack on anything?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Trying to eat better, but think nutrition labels are confusing? Nature Box has a snack for that. They've taken this one too, dude. They've taken out the guesswork and frustration so you can snack confidently and stop wasting time sifting through nutrition labels. Nature Box makes over 100 ridiculously delicious snacks that are made with better-for-you ingredients. Simply choose what snacks you want, and they are delivered right to you. They got great ones like dried white peaches, honey crunch crisps. I think we've got pistachio power clusters here. And
yeah, we do.
What's that one? Simply smoky nut mix. Those power clusters are one of my favorites. Nature Box is constantly adding new interesting snacks for you to discover every month. Plus, they believe you shouldn't eat something you don't like. So if you try a snack you don't like, Nature Box will replace it in your next box for free. You can't do that with your other snacks.
Wait. So if I order something, like let's say I take a risk and I order the Simply Smoky Nut Mix, which with all due respect to our sponsor, I don't think I would like that. But I thought I'll give it a shot. It shows up. I eat it. I go, oh, that's not good. Yeah, so I just go on the website and click and I get a free one?
They'll send you a replacement in the next box you get.
Oh, wow.
So don't even have to worry about it. Just try it. Experiment.
Like,
see what
right
you like.
For abuse.
Go to naturebox.com/roosterteeth right now. Get 2 bags of delicious snacks without any of the junk for free. That's naturebox.com/roosterteeth for 2 free bags of bold and unique snacks delivered right to you. Naturebox.com/roosterteeth. Get 2 bags of snacks for free.
So my kids don't like any
thank you, Nature Box.
Candy. They don't.
Are they actual children or alien children?
But they don't like go out of their way to eat sweets of any kind. Why? Which takes, as a parent, it takes so much bargaining power off the table. Like, oh, you won't get dessert if you don't eat that. Like, I don't want dessert.
So do you have anything you can hold over them?
Pictures? No.
How did you potty train them? Like, what was your, like, incentive for them? Because as...
Well, probably not to have shit in their anus.
As a kid, my parents would give, I believe it was 1 M&M. To me and my brother, if we like use the toilet.
You were so old you can remember being potty trained?
Yeah, I don't. It wasn't a big thing with us.
Yeah.
They told me this.
Oh, okay.
This is not something I remember.
Yeah, that was.
You were at school talking to your friends. It's like, man, I love M&Ms. Yeah.
Kids are all different.
Makes
like
me have to shit for some reason.
Kids are all different. Like some kids will be, you know, they'll have a really tough time doing one thing, and then they'll have a real easy time doing the next thing. The really worst part about having none of you guys have kids. None of you do.
No, we're all.
I just realized that I'm the only parent on the podcast.
You are just realizing
I guess I am. I don't know why. But one of the things that parents do, young parents especially, is they all like tell each other like what month the fucking kid did this or what month they did that. And it's like this like, weird like competitive thing with kids that are under a year old basically. Like he rolled over at 6 months or whatever. And it's like, who gives a shit, you know? It's like, what, he gets to 20 and he never learned to roll over? It's like, he can walk and he can run and he just graduated with an MBA, but he can't roll over.
He's just suffocating.
I've told some of my friends with kids that before, like, oh, yeah, you know, our baby learned to roll over at 6 months. We're like, I don't give a fuck, I can do that. It's like, that's not impressive to me, I can roll over.
I can brag about it, kid.
Like, especially compared to animals.
Yeah.
They plop out and get up and walk around and eat.
Oh, I know. Like a giraffe's up and walking in like a minute and a half.
It's that wonderful time of year where social media is filled with everyone's pictures of everyone's kids going back to school. And I talk about things I do not care about.
How lucky would you be as like an animal in the wild to find a human baby?
I can't relate.
It's like easy.
How lucky would you be?
Yeah, I mean, it's like human babies. Like, they're
like
lousy.
Free food.
Oh, yeah. If you're a tiger or whatever, it's like
jackpot.
It's like finding a pear.
White meat.
It's like, I mean, at least with a baby gazelle, you got to fucking chase it or something. Baby human, you're like, oh, it's fucking snack time. Let's go.
Unless it could roll over, then you're in for a challenge.
Roll away from you.
But Yeah, we didn't. The only time I remember having a trouble with anything, where I felt like it was taking too long, was my oldest JD Jack at the time. We gave him a pacifier, like, you know, kids take pacifiers. We gave him a pacifier. I forget exactly what age, but then like Dummy. Breaking him of the pacifier was it felt like a 3 or 4 month ordeal trying to break him of the pacifier. So it was just like, it was way too hard. And then so we just didn't do any pacifiers with Teddy, basically. We just learned our lesson. But like,
did they suck their thumb at all?
Mm-mm. No. Chef.
I don't know any kids that did that.
JD did this really funny thing where when he learned to crawl, he would use his legs. I was going to say his back legs, but he would use his legs. And he would do this weird thing where he wouldn't use his hands. He would just plant his forehead on the ground like a tripod because we had wood floors, and he would just like slide his head, and he had like this callus in the middle of his head, and we had to break him of that habit too. Like, but that didn't last very long.
Noise?
What?
Like, was it like squeaking on the floor?
It was like a glossy wood floor. It wasn't like splinters and stuff.
Did you have to tape him up to the front of his head?
Yeah. So occasionally, Barbara, he'd make this noise, like, you know, that bare skin on like a slide sound, you know? So, yeah.
And he
developed this like little callus. It was only like, he only did it like 2 weeks or 3 weeks.
That's funny.
And he also did this thing when he was younger. This is great because he started high school today, so it's great to like tell his like little baby stories about him.
Your kid started high school?
JD started high school today. Do you know when by the way, if everybody is suffering through back to school, sorry about that. That sucks, dude. Back to school is like the worst thing ever.
Well, here's what's great about it, though. It gets better. Like right now in my life, today is great.
Yeah, but don't.
I think you're in a bit of a different scenario.
No, just anyway. Once you're done with school, it's like.
Yeah, you suffer through it for a bit, and then, yeah.
So, also, real life like, kind of is hard as well.
What's the age at which you think, Barbara, you don't know how good you have it?
Honestly, high school.
High school?
I think high school was probably, like, looking back, the 16, easiest couple years of my life.
High school was probably the worst time of my life. I fucking hated everything about that.
Really? I mean, I didn't enjoy it, but looking back, it was just like, I had no real responsibilities.
It is 1 million times better right now. This is the best time of my life.
I would say being 4 was the best.
Yeah. Don't even know how good it is.
Yeah, I'd go with that. Yeah.
You don't know how good you got it.
But I did like having like a disposable income and like the ability to go and do things on my own.
You had disposable income in high school?
I had a job.
Burger King, remember?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gavin, you look so befuddled.
I worked at a Burger King in a
movie theater. Disposable income?
Where you make money that you don't have to
spend.
Yeah,
you can just like spend and, you know, it's not accounted for basically, you know? Yeah. You don't have it budgeted, so you can just spend it. It's your disposable income.
Didn't you have rent?
Our parents' house? Did you pay rent when you were in high school?
Yeah.
When you got your job at Waitrose?
Yeah.
Yeah, your parents are terrible. Did you pay rent while you were in high school?
No, as soon as I started working, I was like, paying rent.
Was it after school or while you were still in school?
It was tiny rent, but it was like, I couldn't just be like, man, Waitrose money.
No, any money I made, I could spend on whatever I was doing. It was like, I wasn't paying rent during high school when I was
that doesn't teach you anything about your
F4s and your GDQs?
Yeah, all of my F4s and my print screens.
Were you all the way through it? All the way through your A1s? What is it? A11s?
Oh, right.
Your Dankos?
Fucking school system there.
I watched the school system supercut of you trying to explain the English school system to us.
I was right.
So were you through your GSEs?
GCSEs.
Damn it. GCSEs.
Previously known as O-levels.
Your BDSM?
Were you done with all that stuff?
No, I was doing that stuff.
Okay.
I was 16.
Stop. Gavin, whenever you talk about school, don't take that assumptive tone with me. Like, of course, I was only 16, so of course I was doing my O-levels, formerly known as GCSEs.
No, is it 16 is like when you can work.
Yeah.
And I was just finishing my GCSEs.
Can you work at 15 in the UK? I could work at 15, but I can only work like 20 hours a week.
Family business, just work.
I'm not sure if this is correct, so people tweet me if I'm wrong. I think in Canada you could work if you're 15 as long as you're not handling cash.
That's a weird
thing. You're going to say cats for a second.
Or cats, really.
So
be careful with the livestock.
Driving, what age in Canada and the UK?
15, you could get your G1, which is like, I think you have to be driving.
It's a learner's permit.
Yeah, you have to drive with someone who's had their full license for four years.
I thought you had to watch Screw Attack videos while you were driving.
So what about you? How old can you drive in the UK?
You need to be 30. So
come on, stop it.
That's why I didn't.
Do you even know?
17? 16?
Really?
16,
all right, I'm gonna look this 17?
Up.
No, you don't even know that?
I think it's 17.
Oh, before
I didn't do it, did I?
While I'm thinking of it, only briefly, I want to thank the person, I gotta do a better job of making notes as to who, when somebody sends me something, I get behind.
I just take a picture of the note.
I do. I what I'll do is I'll look at the note, and I'll usually save the envelope if they didn't write their address in the note they sent with it. But somebody sent me their college textbook. It is the Game Design textbook, a Rules of Play anthology, edited by Katie Salen and Eric Zimmerman. And in it is a whole section on red versus blue.
That's a terrible textbook.
People have always sent us like pictures of this, but I've never actually seen a textbook in person where there's a whole chapter about
red versus blue. Did you guys have to give any permissions for that?
Typically we have. I don't remember this one in particular.
But
let me see the publication date on this bad boy.
Or they
it's from the MIT Press. Very prestigious. It's to Hampton. And to Gavin. Must be by that chef. 2006. So, there you go. Keeping it relevant back in 06. It's really cool to see that. It's always weird the places that Red versus Blue does show up. So, that's like a classic example of modern media.
In a museum in Germany.
In German?
People see it a lot, like educational purposes, like that textbook, or like in class, people study it, or like there's a presentation about it.
Especially outside the U.S.
And slow-mo guys.
Yeah.
Seeing a lot of that.
I always make sure that like educational stuff and museums can just use my stuff for free. Just bung it in.
Wow, you're so generous.
Well, I mean, they're not going to be able to pay for it anyway. I at the weekend, I installed my Kinect for my Xbox One.
I saw this picture of this thing.
Did you know when they said you got to have an adapter, would be the Kinect plug is like kind of a square with like a corner cut out.
Right.
It's kind of like a fat, almost like a USB 3.
Very proprietary and very annoying.
I thought it would be that.
Right.
To USB.
Right, just like a little dongle, essentially.
Yeah. I expected it to just be like, plug that in and then dong. No, it's a connection box and a transformer and a plug. So now it takes up two outlets.
And plus it has, from what I can tell, two power boxes.
One is to convert, one is to split the Kinect to USB and power. Also, it only works in there's the picture of it. It only works in one of the USB ports.
Like you have to pick a specific port.
Yeah, it has to be the one next to the HDMI in. And everyone's saying, don't use Kinect. That's a good plan. But I use it. I use voice commands. I use it for like controlling
Netflix.
How much
would you give if the Xbox One S had just had a mic in it? That was it.
That would be ideal.
Why not? Why doesn't it have that?
And a lot of people would be like, I don't want it listening to me all the time. Well, your phone and your Mac and your PCs, all that has mic in it.
Right.
All of them.
And is listening.
And is listening all times.
Yeah, and your TV probably does as well.
Stick a mic in the thing.
Yep. So everyone's in the controller. That's probably near you.
And everyone is saying, we'll just use a headset for voice commands. It's like, if I have a headset on, and surely that's connected to a controller, which means I've got a damn controller in my hand. Why would I use a voice command if I could just...
Yeah.
Also, you don't have to be wearing a headset all the time.
It's
fucking annoying.
It's the worst part. It's very easy to be like... Gaming is the headset.
Walking
Jeff and I were always embarrassed when, like, we'd be wearing headsets and somebody would see us. Yeah. Fucking dorky headsets.
I still don't wear headsets.
It's awful.
I
won't
do it. I don't. But it's nice to just walk through the... Like, Meg left the TV on, Xbox, turn off or whatever. Without having to find a controller, turn it on... And then use it.
What's faster, doing that or saying, hey, Meg, turn off the TV?
Well, she's not in the room, typically.
Your disassociation.
It's just annoying. So now, I plugged all that crap in, and I'm pissed off.
I would love to hear how I talk to... I'm gonna pretend like I'm going to say, having a conversation with my device, but to be nice to people who have one in their homes, I'm going to say, crab box. So when I talk to my devices... I'm always like, I'd love to hear recordings of myself talking to my devices because it's like talking to a kid. It's like, you're not listening to me. I say, I take a very like authoritative tone. It's like, crab box, turn off. Crab box, turn off. I just get immediately like, fall into this like staccato, just like authoritarian thing.
I think
thing
you're
with
just enunciating.
You know, that's what I'm doing, but it makes it sound like I'm
that,
a lunatic.
And sometimes it still doesn't work. So then what I revert to is I talk in robot voice. Like that's my fault. Like after I get angry,
I should try that.
If it still doesn't work, then I talk in robot voice, and then it always works.
That works with Siri.
That's why it's because we talk about Apple products a lot, and everyone knows I use Apple. I use an iPhone and stuff, and you get shit on for using Apple. But it's like sometimes I appreciate Apple because Apple never would have made that abomination to connect the Kinect to their product. They never would have had a device that had two boxes and three plugs and one power outlet.
Also, they wouldn't have renamed Siri. halfway through the iPhone's life cycle just because.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah. You know what's weird is that probably the size difference between the Xbox One and the Xbox One S is all the junk they pulled out for the Kinect. Clearly.
Right.
I mean, all that stuff they pulled out is like almost brings you back up to the form factor mm-hmm. of the Xbox One.
It's so ridiculous. When the box arrived, I was blown away. I was like, why is it in a box that's literally this big for an adapter?
That's terrible.
Do you use the British Siri or the normal American Siri?
British Siri.
I use the British one, too.
Do you really?
Yeah, it sounds fancier.
Does it listen in British, though?
No, she hears me just fine. She just speaks back in British.
She asks if you're up in the duff.
With a British accent, I'm sorry.
Since you're...
My car has a different voice in it, female voice, and Ashley calls it Gigi. So we have Siri and we have Gigi. Oh, even though the one doesn't have a...
I don't like
she
that.
Name it Gigi?
She's named it Gigi.
I don't like
Gigi.
Since you're so upset about the Kinect, I want to show you a video to make you happy.
What's this?
Oh, this is a ram?
This is a sheep dancing competition in Wales that I found.
What?
The one that's just at the bottom facing the wrong way.
Dude, just edit out the sheep. This guy is so entertaining. Look at this one fucking sheep is just chowing away.
Oh, he was blocking a sheep.
Yeah, what the fuck, dude? How is it competition if you can't even see one?
How is he making him
such a fucking bizarre video?
He's gotta be the only contestant. Nobby's up there like,
look at
these
fucks. No, look at the one with the horns.
This is Dougal's time to shine. Dougal's fucking getting
it
on.
Yeah, Dougal's clearly
Sam and Dougal are
show.
Killing it. Nobby doesn't
look
give a
shit. Look at Dougal, man.
It's like, if you're doing this, you can't get your head too close to theirs because I imagine they'll just turn and fucking punk
I love
you.
That the Scottish blackface sheep is literally the only one that doesn't have a blackface. It's literally the only goat up there that doesn't have sheep. Black on its face.
Do you think it's like secretly really cruel when they're stood on a hot plate or something?
Like when you find out Mr. Ed was being shocked.
Is that true?
Is that how they did it?
And then they would have like little electrodes to give him a little shock, or they'd put peanut butter on the roof.
I heard that
mouth.
Was all a load of bollocks, and it was just a well-trained horse.
Mr. Ed? When was the last time you thought about Mr. Ed?
It was recently, because the guy who played Wilbur just died.
Oh, did he really?
Like a month ago, right?
That got a good long life.
Yeah.
Let me see. Mr. Ed.
The control room's asking me for a link to that sheep video. I just closed it. I'll see if I can find it again.
How much would you pay for a pot of glue made from Mr. Ed?
Mr. Ed ran 8 years. A show
that's
about
that is a long
horse.
Ass run,
dude. A talking horse. It has a 7.1 out of 10 on IMDb. Unbelievable.
I don't know why that video reminded me. I just sent you a link to another video.
You want me to play this?
I want you to. I don't know why this reminded me of this video, but I saw this recently. I think on Reddit, and it made me laugh super hard.
I think it's because your ear is out that you look young. Yeah. Oh, there you go.
So this is what what Barbara just sent me.
What is that?
Oh, dildo race.
That's pretty funny. Don't cut away from this. I want to see which one wins.
Well, that purple one is stunning.
Clearly, I got Aqua. Aqua's looking pretty good.
I don't know. Oh!
It went so fast the camera couldn't keep up.
I don't know if that was lag or whether the dildo just had a burst
of
speed.
I'm suspecting something.
The thing is, do you want the fastest one or the slowest
one? See,
this
is where if Tesla was still alive, he would have designed...
In the race, you want the fastest one.
He would have designed a dildo with the ultimate resonance that would definitely win the race.
We lost track of the fucking Aqua one.
I think that one won, though.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm kind of sad.
Is it bringing your own dildo? Because they were all remarkably similar models.
I don't know.
I was kind of sad that there's no dude at the end bent over.
I just want to see the one that goes down like this.
Like the rabbit
the
one?
The rotate a rabbit one, like rotating as it goes down.
Let's see. Can I see if I find more info? There's no more info on this.
I have a problem.
On what?
Too bad.
The dildo race.
Oh. I thought you were looking at
my what's
Mr.
your problem?
I got another flat tire.
How many have you gotten?
I think I have more flat tires.
Well, you did drive to a quarry once.
And that was the last flat tire I got. So that was when we filmed in the quarry. I got a flat tire then, and I got a flat tire again today. Different tire.
Different quarry?
Nope. Didn't go in any more quarries. Although I did drive over to the armory. Next year, we have the weirdest names for stuff here.
That's when I get them, too.
When you go to the armory?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm done driving over there.
That's probably because of all the stuff I've blown up over there.
Yeah.
Every time I take my car to the armory, I'll get a flat tire.
Yeah. It just sucks, dude. I mean, we have a really cool facility here, but it's just like, I feel like when people are done making a set for production, not our people, but just anybody who's using this area for production, they just basically take a handful of screws and just scatter them across the parking lot. I've gotten more flat tires since we've been in this facility than I have probably in the rest of my life combined. We've only been here like 2 or 3 years
two.
At this point. So it's very frustrating to me.
It's only been 2 years.
Yeah, it was May, 2 years ago in
2014.
May, yeah. May, we were a little bit over 2 years because we moved in May. But there's another reason why I hate flat tires now is because, and this is really embarrassing to admit, the Tesla does not have a spare tire in the car because you're not allowed to jack up the car. You have to jack it up in a very precise way.
You're not allowed because it will break the car?
First of all, the car's heavy as shit. So you need a bigger jack, which they could supply in the car.
On a regular car, you're supposed to jack it up only in certain places anyway, too.
That is true. The difference being, and it seems like it's pretty easy. It's a spot, and you just have to hit right on it and then jack it up from there. If you miss it, there's the risk you could puncture a lithium battery, and then your day is a lot worse really, really quickly.
Because your car just caught on fire?
Yeah, because your car will just explode and catch on fire. And, so
damn, Teslas are fucking heavy.
Yeah.
How heavy are they?
Depending, between 4,500 and 5,000 pounds.
Yeah. It's heavier than my pickup.
What's that in tons?
What's a normal car?
It's over 2 tons, 2.5 tons.
A normal car, I would estimate, would probably be about 2,500 to 3,000 pounds.
So that's 2,000 pounds to a ton?
Yeah. That's what it is in the U.S. Yeah.
Why not?
What?
Why not just do 1,000?
Oh, I know.
2,000?
Did you see Twitch is putting out this thing where they have you buy bits?
Yeah.
And then you give people bits when they're streaming.
Yeah.
They're selling you 100 bits for $1.40.
Brilliant.
So we're back at Microsoft points.
Why is Twitch going backwards?
No, it's the best. It's smart.
It's like Microsoft points.
It's so smart. They detach the value of real currency from their currency. So when you're spending it, you really aren't connecting. It's not like, oh, I'm spending $5. It's like, oh, I'm spending 70 woozits or whatever.
But what's the first thing you do when you have to spend 70 woozits? You figure out how much money it is.
Yeah, but if it's an inconvenient amount, like 1.4 cents or something, then it's like, oh, then you're rounding. Like, it's not at all the same.
I think it's dumb.
I think it's dumb too. I think it's really smart. Also, it's really beneficial for another reason.
Every other platform has moved away from that system.
The other reason it's beneficial for them is that they are the payment processor directly.
Yes.
And Twitch has a big problem where sometimes people will give a big donation to a streamer, then initiate a chargeback on their card saying it wasn't
legitimate. Patreon too.
This is separate because then the transaction has happened previously. You've already made your transaction for the bits and then you're just giving bits to someone else.
So you can't charge back your bits.
We talked about the podcast. There was a case of a guy who did that to 20 or 30 people. And then refuted all the charges or did a charge back on them all. And they honored all of them and charged the kids an outrageous amount of money.
It was a kid from Australia, I believe. And I think he had given a $10,000 donation and tried to charge that back.
And he would record the streamer's reactions and then post those as his videos.
So harsh.
Yeah.
Terrible.
That's messing with emotions right there.
Yeah, but he ended up having to pay everything that he committed to. They made him pay all of it.
Wow.
Good.
I mean, they really just make an example out of that one person, but it works. I bet less people will do that now.
Yeah, well, I mean, you see someone, you're like, oh, shit, yeah. If you're really on the hook for it,
yeah,
that's bad. There was
But, I mean, really, every platform, though, Gus, has moved away from that. Microsoft, you just buy things directly. The worst, honestly, I think, is, if you don't have to do it, but, things that make you have, a wallet, a Steam wallet or whatever. The Microsoft points, I thought, were really egregious because, basically,
Good for global, I guess.
Why would it be better for global, though?
Because then you don't have to say, this game is $17 and here it's £12. You just say, this game is 2,000 Microsoft points. And that's
then you adjust the value of the point.
One image, that's one post.
Yeah, but then you'll have to do the calculation once for selling the points.
Well, basically. Everyone does their own calculations. They don't have to make multiple posts about an announcement.
Yes.
That does make sense.
I wonder, though,
that's smart,
when
Adam.
You were in the Xbox 360 and the point system existed, how much were arcade games when you downloaded them?
I want to say 400 points.
No. I think they were 800 and 1600, weren't they?
I believe you are correct.
I believe so.
What was 400?
I think some shitty games were 400.
Like the games you liked.
Defender.
Defender's
I remember
a great
stuff
game.
Like I'm Trials, adding. I think it was 1200.
There they are. What's bits.
Yes.
That's how much the bits
cost. Then you get a discount, so the rate of the bits goes down as you buy more.
Smart, further obfuscating the actual value of the bit.
I know, I just don't like it.
What
I don't,
is the point
I don't
of
find it,
it
honest.
So does
I find
that, it, that doesn't it like, change the amount of
I find
money
it
that.
I'm dishonest by design.
What is the point of the bits, though, for
I don't think it's
Twitch?
Dishonest.
It's to tip someone?
Yeah, yeah. So I get, hey, Barbie did great. Here's a cheer. It's called a cheers, right? Or a cheer?
Why don't you just give a donation or subscribe?
Because apparently they wanted to move to this bit system.
Also, when you do it, it has a little animated graphic.
Yeah.
Well, they can make an animated graphic for the donations, too.
But it, helps draw attention to it as well.
Also, why not just make it a dollar amount, man?
I don't get it.
The reason why they do it, here's why they do it. So you go out, Barbara, and you go, oh, I love all these streamers and everything. It's great. I'm going to buy $100 worth of bits. So you spend $100. Well, you multiply by that by like 4 million users.
Yeah.
Then 4 million people have given Twitch $100 each. And Twitch is just holding all those funds
just
at that point in time.
Just to use for whatever streamer
they
want.
Made all the money day one, you know, and they just have to wait to pay it out.
I mean, it's smart on their part, for sure.
And like, you might spend all those bits over the course of 3 or 4 months or 6 months, and it's typical thing, like for one of these platforms, is the aggregation of all of that at once is a very powerful thing. I mean, Twitch might be sitting on tens of millions of dollars at a time.
Additionally, they use Amazon Payments as their processor for all of these payments. Yeah. So they get, since they're the processor, they get charged even less
that's
for
why I
credit card
it
transactions.
It's because I assume they're making no money on a PayPal donation, but now they can actually make
money
on
donations.
Right,
they lose a percentage of the money on that. Now it's like it's all in-house first party since they're owned by Amazon.
And where do you see those little animations?
In chat.
In the chat?
Mm-hmm.
You get on the screen too.
I don't really like when people do like those animations on the screen or things like that, because it's just like I'm trying to watch this person stream or do this thing, and it's like I'm constantly seeing like this person donated $5.
Well, that's
like
the culture of that whole audience, though. Is
I just like
that.
I dislike it. It makes it hard to watch Twitch streamers when it's like that for me. I just want to see them play the game.
Yeah, I just honestly I feel like Twitch isn't the place to do that now. If
you
just want to
like
see
YouTube
someone play
gaming?
A game seriously.
Okay, this is from Vice. The name of the guy who tried to do it was iNexus_Ninja.
Was that on his birth certificate?
Yeah. Yeah, sure it was. iNexus Ninja, as it turns out, is an 18-year-old kid from Australia. Way to go. Named Anthony Archer. A now-deleted tweet discovered by Reddit users months ago reportedly suggested he used his parents' credit card to pay for the shenanigans, where he would make large donations and then do a chargeback. And the card apparently carried that kind of load just fine. And then PayPal said they're not going to refund him. That's it. He's got to pay it.
If I recall properly, going through this person's Twitter timeline, I saw pictures that led me to believe that he will not miss the money very much.
Yeah? Really?
Huh. Yeah.
What was the picture you saw?
Just like some nice cars and lots of traveling.
Still.
Women?
No, he's still a younger dude. Was he 18? Did you say that?
Yeah, I think he was like
18. Yeah, I think younger dude.
Man, that's like that's one of those like karma things that people love to hear about.
Mm-hmm.
I got
something else I want to read here.
No, you don't.
I want to remind everyone, this episode of the RT Podcast is also brought to you by Betterment. It's never too late to save for retirement and other financial goals. Betterment has changed the industry by making investing easier. Betterment is the largest independent automated investing service, managing more than $5 billion for over 175,000 customers. The financial services industry has embraced technology and innovation through the creation of automated investing, meaning you keep more of your money with fees that are a fraction of what you pay with traditional financial services. Betterment is a member of the SIPC, which means your investments are protected. Bank-level security means your personal data is too. Right now, get up to 6 months of no fees. Learn how at betterment.com/teeth. That's betterment.com/teeth. Betterment, investing made better. Very smart site. I spent a lot of time on their website looking over their service. It's fantastic.
When did you start saving for retirement?
I started really late.
You did start late.
Because it was shotgun for a while, right?
Yeah, it was shotgun. It was probably...
I tried to tell him.
It was after I got married. My wife was concerned about long-term planning.
I've heard that Betterment don't
I was so
accept
confused
that
for
as one of your answers.
No, you cannot say shotgun.
I was like, what plan is shotgun? And then I realized
I was probably...
You weren't going to use a shotgun on yourself.
30, 31 maybe? Before starting?
I tried to fight these guys like hell. All the time. Mm-hmm. Like stuff like that. Make them get life insurance. You know, things like that. Would you guys get married? Some of us had kids.
Oh yeah, I do have life insurance. I should take care of myself. Yeah.
Don't say that to your wife.
How much?
Like $5.
Here's something to consider: is that there's a thing called the rule of 72, which is it's how you determine how long it'll take for any invested amount of money to double based on the interest that you're getting. Basically, called the rule of 72 because you take your interest rate, expected interest rate, and you divide it by that number, the interest rate number. Let's say you earn. Get some good investments, you can make 10% a year on your investment. Mm-hmm. 10%. Then in 7 years, your money will double. 7.2 years.
Oh, so you divide 72
percentage. By the actual integer, you know, of your percentage. And so if your money doubles every 7 years, Barbara, how old are you, if I may ask?
I just turned 27.
And how old do you think you might live to? Just guess.
I'm hoping at least...
Let's say 90.
95?
Bloody hell.
And you're how old?
27.
27. Okay.
I think. 27. Wait,
so let's do
I?
This real quick. So you go 34.
Yes.
Then you go 41. Then you go 48. Then you go 55. Then you go 62. Then you have 69. Then you have 76. Then you have 83. And if you make it to 90, you have 90. That's nine periods that your money will double. So let's say you put away right now, you put away $10,000.
Then I only have nine more sets of 7 years.
Yeah, pretty scary when you look at it like that. But look at this. If you put away, let's say $10,000. Let's say we were to scrape together $10,000 and you put that away. It doubles nine times. So you get 20,000, then you have 40,000, you have 80,000, you have 160,000, you have 320,000, you have 640,000, you have 1.2 million, 2.4 million, and $4.8 million.
Yeah, but what am I going to do with $4.8 million when I'm 90?
But it's only because you put away $10,000 when you were 27.
Is that still the case?
That's, I mean, isn't that from the dream days? That's assuming you get a 10%
return. Well, as you get a 10% return, that's a pretty aggressive return.
Right.
But it's to illustrate the point. I mean, if you, let's say you get 6%, then it's...
Well, it's like the whole thing of like you get... What? You start with a penny, but it doubles every day for a month. And you end up with a crap load of money.
Yeah, but that's a made-up hypothetical scenario.
This is real.
Yeah, but stuff doubling is mental.
I've had money put away since I was 12.
Have you really?
Mm-hmm.
Was it like special money?
What do you get? It was from my bat mitzvah.
Did you? So you
bat mitzvah?
So what's done with that?
My bat mitzvah. Bar mitzvah is for men.
I thought it was B-A-H-T, right?
Oh.
Is it B-A-T or B-A-H-T?
B-A-T.
B-A-T.
Bat mitzvah.
It sounds different. Yeah.
It's butt.
The way she says it, it's more like
it's
butt.
It's a Hebrew word. Yeah. So it's not bat mitzvah.
Mitzvah. Bat mitzvah. But so what do you do with that? Like, you just invest it in stuff?
I mean, my parents did it for me.
Do you check out on a regular basis, see how it's doing?
Mm-mm.
Really? You just
I don't want to touch it.
Just take a look and be amazed.
Yeah,
like 401k, fighting Gus to do 401k forever. And then you look back and it's like, oh, because the company will put money into a 401k. Anyway, go to betterment.com and learn about investing.
Betterment has tons of retirement stuff like that.
The sooner you start, the better.
Money doubling, having money, like we put away a little bit of money and then it just grows.
Anybody like in their 60s or 70s, they'll all say the same thing. Put away some money.
You know what the problem is, though?
Don't have a wedding, take the money.
They call it 401k.
So?
I can't think of anything more boring sounding. 401k?
What do you want it to sound like? Have retirement money plan. Fun. I mean, what the fuck? That's a stupid thing to say.
It's a stupid name.
Yeah, it's a stupid name. Everything's stupid.
Like, the 1040 form is for your taxes. I mean, it's just...
What's the number of a form? Where's 401h?
401k is the law.
Right? What are the other ones around it?
401J
and 401L?
Yeah, right? What are those?
Who knows?
Other investments, tax protection.
It's called 401K because $401,000 is the ideal amount of money.
And it doubles every 7 years.
That's exactly right. There's all sorts of crazy decisions, too. When I was younger, I had to decide between a traditional IRA for retirement stuff or a Roth IRA before any company I worked for had 401K stuff. And this is a weird thing. So what do you think you'd want to do? So, essentially, that if you get a traditional IRA, you put the money in and you get a tax benefit because you can put more money in. Say I get $100, I can put all $100 in and I don't have to pay taxes on the $100 because I put it into an IRA.
So it's like an ISA.
Down the road, when I pull it out, I have to pay taxes on the money as I pull it out. Or I take the $100.
It's not like an ISA.
Put it in a Roth IRA, pay the taxes on it. I pay 33, well, assuming.
Whatever. Yeah.
Say pay $33 of it in taxes. I got about $67 left. I put that in the Roth IRA. Whatever that turns into, I can pull out tax-free. I don't get taxed on the thing. So you're just
talking about this, and Gavin talking about the school system in the UK is pretty much on par right now.
Yeah, but you don't need to know. But you need to know about what I'm talking about.
Tax it on the way in.
You think take the tax on the way in? Depends on your age, I think.
Right. Like you tax on the way in. If it grows enough, then you make money by not having to tax on the way out.
Yes. I mean, you're starting with a lower principal.
Right.
Theoretically.
Well, being taxed at source is always nicer later.
Unless it's not too much later.
And you never know if the tax laws change.
Yes.
Over the length of time.
As well. Also, be prepared for any time you invest money, it will immediately go down.
Immediately.
In the short term, immediately go down. That's always awful.
You always have to take a long view on that stuff.
Because
especially if you're planning for retirement.
The resets, and there's been two in my life so far, the resets on financial stuff, they're pretty fucking serious when they happen. Like the .com crash was pretty fucking serious. And then 2008,
like
the housing crash,
hundreds of thousands.
Very fucking serious.
But you always have to have faith that things will. You're the opposite of Joel Heyman. the economy will eventually recover.
Did I ever tell
and
you?
Continue
you know
to
what?
Grow.
Here's the way that I look at it. Sorry, Barbara, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I look at it, to your point, Gus. The way I look at it is that there's enough people involved with the system that they're invested to make sure that it works.
Yes.
That's more so than the faith that I have that all this stuff actually does make sense, as opposed to like, oh, you know, I mean, look what happened in 2008. When it all fell apart, everyone's like, no, it didn't. Here's your money. You're okay. You're fine. You're fine. You know, the banks aren't going to go
under. Well, some people
jumped
in front of trains, though.
Yeah. I would never. I could go back and work at Waitrose, you know?
Joel's always obsessed that the system doesn't work. That's all going to fall apart. The numbers don't add up. But like what you say, there are people there who are invested to make the system work.
Right. And it has, you know,
and it continues to grow.
I just, you know, it's the idea that like the economy will collapse to the point where paper currency will mean nothing and people will want gold. It's like people are going to want food.
Right.
You know, they're going to want fresh water.
Yeah, buy a fucking farm and learn how to grow corn.
Yeah.
You'll do way better with that.
Start storing gasoline in barrels. You know, I actually thought about that. Like, remember we were talking about buying a barrel of gas when it got down to like...
We got our oil right over there.
When it was down to like $1.33 a gallon at the pump.
Yeah.
And it's like, holy cow, for gasoline, not for oil. But it would have been cool to do that and see. But it would be so much work to store all that fucking oil.
Did I ever tell you what Joel said to me one time, which made me know he was crazy? I mean, amongst a few.
Anything?
Kids.
Was he sitting next to you on a plane?
Did he say, hi, Barbara, my name's Joel Heyman. That guy's fucking nuts.
This was like... I think right before I started working at Rooster Teeth, I was talking to Joel about something. First and he said mistake. He was looking into buying a Hummer. And I was like, oh, like, that's cool. Why?
It's a very non... Joel's a car guy?
Yeah.
That's a very non-Joel car.
And I said, why do you want to get a Hummer? And he said, well, you know, inevitably when the economy goes to shit and everyone goes crazy, I want to be able to drive through the crowds of people losing their minds. And I was like, ha, 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 ha. He goes, no, I'm serious. I'll be able to drive through everybody and nobody will be able to touch me.
Economics is such a, like, just fabricated science. It's way more philosophy than science that if you go deep into enough, you get to, like, sci-fi stuff. You really do. You get to, like, you get stuff like Bitcoin, mm-hmm. which is yeah. just, it's
and,
crazy.
And Twitch bits.
And Twitch
or cheers,
bits.
Cheers or whatever.
Twitch bits. Yeah. You like Bitcoin? Bits, you like Twitch bits? Do you like Bitcoin?
I like the idea. I don't like Bitcoin specifically, but I like the idea of a digital currency.
I don't see how people who think a paper currency is garbage and they think Bitcoin is better.
No.
It's like, I mean, basically anything can be money if people decide it's valuable.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And
I like that governments believe in paper money.
Yeah. Governments probably aren't going
to. See, I'm so in the mindset of, yeah, I guess if everything goes to crap, it's nice if you have a bunker ready full of food and you're well prepared. But I would much rather be someone who enjoyed life the entire way and then was screwed for a little bit at the end, as opposed to completely adjusting my life and preparing my entire life for something that may or may not happen and maybe not living my life to the full.
Oh, there was a really cool thing that was on Reddit earlier this week. Did you see it? It was a 50s era bomb shelter underneath a Nevada house.
I did not see
and
that.
And it had like a
That's
fake.
Still fully functional?
It looks like the set of a Fallout movie. It's like.
We should have filmed our immersion.
And I don't mean like a vault. It looks like. I'll get some pictures of it. I'll show you guys.
I just watched, for the first time, 10 Cloverfield Lane.
Oh, fucking
great,
love that movie.
Great movie. I actually like, when I saw it on iTunes, I was like, oh, Gus was like raving about this movie when it was out. So I'm going to check it out. It was not what I expected at all.
I know, that's the best part.
Yeah, I never actually saw Cloverfield. So
whenever
really
John
know.
Goodman was on the screen, I was just so excited.
So,
every time he came back, I was like, what
really
is going
to
happen?
You saw the movie.
Yeah.
You have
hey,
not
internet,
seen-
help me. If you guys saw that link to that Fallout shelter on Reddit this week, send it to me. Exactly.
Have you seen 10 Cloverfield Lane?
I absolutely have, and it's a great movie.
It's okay. Fantastic.
Fucking love John Goodman.
No, it was really good. I think they did. You don't have to have seen Cloverfield. I think they did a great job with the trailer.
It's,
I mean,
nothing to do with Cloverfield.
And then put it together. It's like so good, so good,
so good.
I feel like there's a few movies I've seen.
Hey, it's me.
This year that have been really good.
Oh, that's it.
Look, there's also an ad for the. First
is this on screen right now?
No, that's not on stream.
Oh. Okay, so
they're trying to
get it
sized. They'll get it there. Yeah, 10 Cloverfield Lane was one of those movies that I really, really enjoyed this year.
Yeah, and that reminded me of the whole like having a bomb shelter and stuff that's mm-hmm. fully prepared.
Being ready for
super paranoid
a potential disaster. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm so ready.
That movie's
to not
on,
be ready.
On digital and physical discs now. Go out and buy it or rent
it's
it.
It's on
or
like
whatever.
The iMovies or whatever. If you're on, you have Apple TV.
It's on planes too. If you're about to take a flight.
Absolutely, watch it. God, it's so good.
So great.
All right, so we have this Fallout shelter. Do we have that?
I think they're still getting it adjusted. Oh, there we go.
Oh, here it is.
Yeah. That's all underground?
Yeah, it was underneath a house, I believe, in Nevada.
Oh, so they like turfed it?
Let's go
was it AstroTurf?
This looks like that movie with
Go ahead and go through them, guys. I think there you go.
What's the guy's name?
But he's got like fake trees. This is underground.
That's like Nuketown.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen?
It's got like painted walls.
Blast from the Past, that movie.
Somebody, I think somebody mentioned that in the comments.
Is it Brendan Fraser in there?
Yeah,
or something?
This looks exactly like Blast from the Past.
Who are you kidding? Is that like a fun project, or were they actually hoping to use this?
Yeah, look at that kitchen, dude.
They should rent this out.
This would be really great when we're trapped underground for 3 decades.
I mean, that would be lush for the end of the world, but
yeah.
Wait! Go back.
Cut.
Okay, I thought that was a kitchen first. I thought that was a kitchen counter with a toilet.
No, let me tell you something.
Is it a carpeted bathroom?
We went through a weird period where people would put wall-to-wall carpeting in their bathroom.
That's disgusting. So
fucking
gross.
Lunacy.
Disgusting.
Absolute lunacy to put.
And if you're going
to
do that, you got to at least have a fuzzy toilet.
Gross.
Dude, I had carpet in my bathroom.
I feel like that would just be full of piss.
You know, when I was looking for a house one time.
You put those carpet things around the toilet.
Well, for the audio listeners, we will put a link to this in the link dump so that you can see it as well. But it's basically like it's an underground complex that someone built. There's a pool in there too.
This image to me is creepy.
Stuff on the walls.
Where it's like you have a ceiling outside.
And it's like all this artificial light. They could have made barbecue.
That's like out of the Flintstones right there.
It's pretty nuts, dude.
Yabba-dabba-doo.
How much must that have cost?
I don't know. But somebody was convinced the world was going to end. And I don't think that's Joel's thing.
They must have hired a guy to do a mural down there.
I don't think Joel is like a pessimist and he wants the world to end. I just think he wants to have the scenario where the most amount of people are wrong and he's right. That's what I think he's trying to set up. It's a very long play.
But it just seems so much easier just to not worry about it.
That's your MO. Just don't even worry about it. Don't even sweat it.
The world, of course, will end.
Rhett and Link did a whole episode on this thing for Good Mythical Morning.
The Bunker?
Mm-hmm. That's a good show.
It's a great show.
I like those guys. Those guys are talented guys.
Did you see that that Yelp review of a laser tag place on Reddit last week?
No, I did. No. These are the guys, the three
it's
friends?
It's like three guys who are friends who like, look like they're in their early 20s, decide they want to go play laser tag. They show up at the laser tag place, and they said there's 15 little kids there. And they're like talking to the kids like, you want us to split up? Like we split into teams and have the grown-ups on both of the teams? And the little kids start chanting, grown-ups versus kids, grown-ups versus kids. So it's like the three of them against 15 little kids. And the Yelp review goes on to post pictures of the final score, which was 73,700 to negative 1,100.
How did that happen?
They just proceeded to wipe the floor and destroy these 15 kids.
How do you get a negative?
I mean, how happy does that make you? Oh. Yeah, that's amazing.
You're very happy about
that, amazing.
Right?
This fucking destroyed them. And then like the Yelp review has a picture of them, the three guys, and then also like the score below it.
Oh, man. I wish I had a picture of the kids, too.
I just imagine like little kids crying.
Yeah.
There it is. They found that really fast.
So great.
I also love that the Yelp review is only 4 stars.
I thought that was going to go the complete opposite direction because usually kids are really good at laser tag. They're just sneaky and fast.
Yeah, but they don't really
And I'm
have
old
tactics.
And my bones creak.
No coordination.
The barometer makes your bones creak.
Creak.
So, maybe a slightly controversial topic, but I'm curious to know your opinion on this.
This has been a serious podcast.
Has it?
We talked about like interest rates.
So
Gawker
shut down.
Fuck Gawker.
Oh,
okay.
That's awesome.
What's controversial about that?
So I think the way that they have
Hulk
handled
Hogan's getting money.
They have handled all of this announcement and the way that they've portrayed themselves throughout this entire ordeal and all of their sister sites or all of their children's sites, whenever they report on it, it's like our parent company Gawker shutting down after it was revealed that there was a clandestine legal attack by billionaire Peter Thiel. It's like,
really?
Come on, that's really how you're going to frame the news?
Also, why would they want to give the guy that much credit if he really like submarined their business? Like he put them out of fucking business.
How?
He basically just funded Hulk Hogan's lawsuit against him.
Mm.
Which, by the way,
they were wrong. They did something
it's
illegal.
It's not like this billionaire gave him Hulk Hogan's sex tape where he's banging his friend's wife, you know? Which, by the way, Hulk Hogan did a hell of a misdirect on that. That was a hell of a PR campaign where he put a company out of fucking business and came out. Everybody's on Hulk Hogan's side from this whole thing. They also did a terrible thing where they posted a video of a girl having sex. She was drunk and having sex on the floor
in a bathroom.
Yeah. I just read the story. I'd never heard it before. And, the girl called and said, just please take down that video. Like somebody else recorded it and it was in public. So they said that they could post it. And then the dad called and said like people at work are like posting screenshots or like, say I'm having to see this for the last few days. And I'm like, get over it. And it's just like, you sound like the worst people on the fucking planet.
I think what he said was, I'm having to watch my daughter get sexually assaulted on a floor filled with piss.
On a pile of piss, I think is, yeah.
Oh, God.
Yeah, and I think you're right. Their response was essentially to the effect of, deal with it.
Or he said, don't make a big deal about this.
Jesus Christ.
Because that'll just reveal to people who you are. So just like, kind of like, just go with it. It'll blow over, you know.
So I've been very surprised by their almost like flippant attitude about the loss and the shutdown.
Good riddance,
blaming
dude.
It on this clandestine legal assault by Peter Thiel, with another person that they fucking wronged in the past.
Didn't they post the video? Some like stalker took a video of Aaron Andrews.
Oh, did they post that video?
I don't know if Gawker posted that.
I don't know if
maybe
they did.
Okay, I don't know.
I don't know if they did.
Yeah. Anyone who would. That's just like.
So I guess.
So fucked up. So does he make a shitload of money?
It's still in the appeals process.
Okay.
Which is why I think they never apologize for it, and maybe why they frame it this way, so they don't have any admission of wrongdoing until the appeals process is exhausted. I don't know, but it's just weird to me to see them always talk to. And it's not only them. Like I said, it's their other sites like Kotaku. Anytime they talk about Gawker shutting down, has like the same little boilerplate about this clandestine legal assault. So it's just weird.
What was the company that bought the stolen iPhone that one time?
That was Gizmodo?
Gizmodo, yeah.
That's a different company?
Who owns... who?
I think they're live.
I'm whispering, Justin. You can say it out loud.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah? Does Gizmodo... Who's their parent company?
I think it was Gawker.
I think it's Gawker. Yeah.
See, I just thought we like piled them into the same lump.
Gizmodo drove me fucking crazy. They would always do things... They were just
like
incendiary.
Unboxing?
Yeah, like the unboxing with the Halo stuff
thing,
where they
just
threw it
out the window.
They threw it all out the window after they were done with it. Yeah. And then,
it's just disrespectful.
And the worst thing to me, which really infuriated me, was the time that they went to a trade show with one of those remotes that you can push the button and it runs through all the turn-off
codes.
It was
CES.
CES.
God,
huge convention here in the US. And basically it's a button. People use them in bars. You point at the TV, you push the button, it finds the remote code to turn off.
It goes through
that
every
TV
remote
really
code.
Fast. It runs through every remote code for off. And so people be in the middle of a presentation, they kept just shutting their stuff off. Typically, they're showing off that product to a group of people.
And probably didn't think to tape over the IR sensor on it.
No, and they kept shutting it off. And then they published this. I mean, it's a tech blog, and they did this. And then their response when people got upset with them for ruining people's jobs, their response was, you'll get over it.
Yeah,
don't be so uptight.
Presentations with brand new televisions being unveiled and demoed for the, you know.
Yeah, a tech website is ruining the future of tech.
And it's like, oh, yeah, cool. Now this television company can't sell their TV. Because it shut off.
Fuck you.
For years after that video came out, I would have to tape over our IR sensors when we had displays in our booth. Because then it was like, great, now everybody's got the idea. They're all going to fucking do this at every event.
Yep.
So, great. So thank you for giving me all that extra work, too. Then there was another, well, I know we're really at time here. But there's one more thing I wanted to bring up that I saw late last week. I don't know if any of you guys saw this. Did you see that YouTuber who went to North Korea and made a music video?
No.
Mm-mm.
I forget the guy's name. I'll have to look it up. I believe he's a British YouTuber who he has like a travel adventure vlog. And he went to North Korea for 7 days, Lewis Cole. And he did travel vlogs for 7 days in North Korea. And then
Louis?
Maybe.
Is it L-O-U-I-S?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I didn't know he went. I know that guy.
Then he capped it off with a music video. I think it was called, Surfing in the DPRK. It's really bizarre. He says that, of course, that it wasn't sponsored by the North Korean government. But it's a really weird thing to do with one of the most oppressive governments in the world to go. And he said that, you know, I watched the videos. He's talking to people there, you know, showing what he's being... see what he's being shown, but it's like you have a very limited scope on what you can see. It's like you aren't talking to everyday people. You're talking to like essentially actors who are being paid to say certain things and act a certain way in front of you. And it was just really, really bizarre to me to go and make those videos and then publish them. And of course, they're all really popular. I mean, they've been tons of views because people are talking about it. It's controversial now.
Yeah, he's huge, but people don't remember how he started. He's basically using his second channel now as his main channel. And it's called Fun for Louis.
Yeah.
His original
his first
channel.
Thing was, wouldn't he just eat a bunch of stuff?
His original channel is called Food for Louis, where he just ate gross stuff.
And
like,
fun
he would
for
eat
Louis?
Roadkill and stuff. It was awesome.
I remember that.
Yeah.
That's the same guy.
Yeah. I think he just, like.
He pivoted.
He was like, yeah, this is like, I can't market this anyway. I think he was working with Apple at one point, too.
I've eaten
so Vanity Fair asked him and his representation if he was being paid by North Korea for propaganda. And the response was, this trip to North Korea was inspired by a friend who has been on 17 trips to North Korea since 2007, running humanitarian relief work in communities which need it. The purpose of the trip was to join a team of volunteers in teaching local tour guides and children how to surf and skateboard as part of an annual surf camp, which first launched in 2014.
Is that American
Louis saw this as a unique opportunity to be immersed in the culture.
Is the American guy who stole the poster still stuck there?
What, he stole a poster?
No, I think he's got booted from the country. I think he's back.
What's the scariest thing you've ever seen come out of North Korea? Out of like any documentary secret footage?
There's a lot of interviews, and again, you don't know how much of this to believe, right? There's a lot of interviews with people who have supposedly escaped North Korea who will draw images recreating what they experienced in prison camps in North Korea.
Oh.
And it's like images of dogs eating people and like people just chained up in rooms and being tortured by guards. There's a lot of really, really bad stuff.
Well, yours is way worse than mine. I was going to talk about how creepy the fake grocery stores.
Yeah,
did you ever see that?
And you can't buy anything. There's no cash registers.
There's nothing in there. It's just fake grocery stores with a bunch of fake food in it. So it looks like everything's going great, but it's like they're just fake grocery stores and they're super well lit and everything.
I think there's a fake house on a mountain somewhere that you can see from South Korea. So it makes it look like North Korea has a really nice thing, but it's like completely fake.
There's a documentary coming out. I think it might be out now. It might be a limited release. I don't think it's playing in Austin. I forget what it's called. I'll look it up and I will put it in the link up. But there's a documentary that a couple of people made where they went to North Korea to film this documentary. But of course, the government goes through all your footage and deletes stuff that they don't think is appropriate. But all the cameras they use had two flashcards.
Oh,
so they would hand over one and then keep the other one in the camera in secret. So they got a bunch of unapproved footage out of the country. And it's supposed to be really, really interesting.
Enough people do this, somebody's going to get caught doing this, and we're never going to hear from that person again.
That's crazy. You won't know when it happens.
Yeah, I don't like, you know, it's one of those things. I know we got to end the show, but is it the Cincinnati Zoo?
Yeah.
They just recently put out a statement saying, don't make any more jokes about Harambe.
Yeah.
They don't want any more memes. Let it die, please. You know, the people that took care of this gorilla love this gorilla, and they had to kill the gorilla. They had to put it down. And then there's a lot of people all over the world just kind of laughing about it, you know, and it's like they're just...
I don't even understand how the memes even started about it. Like, it's such a tragic incident, and it's like people just took off with it.
It's just one of those things where it's like a meme is essentially, it's a joke somebody makes, and if somebody else repeats it, then it just basically becomes a meme, you know? That's it.
Yep.
And then the repeating becomes its own thing. But something like this, where they make that statement... That just kind of like, you know, it's going to make it last probably another 3 months now that they asked people to stop doing it. So I forget where I was going with that. But anyway, just I think it's interesting when people think they can like affect the way that people are going to talk about something. It just never works out.
Right. No.
Barbara, especially as a new American, understands what I'm talking about.
I do. Free speech.
Somewhat American.
You can't, green. You can't control the memes.
You said to me when you called me a slut today. You said free speech.
Free speech, bitch.
Free speech, bitch.
All right. Well. About time to wrap this up, the serious edition.
Bring it on,
podcast.
Do you have the number of that immigration lawyer?
Thanks everybody for watching. We'll see you guys next week.
See ya.
Watch Always Open.